Good evening. Thank you very much, and I hope you continue to enjoy your dinner as we go forward. My name is Roger Berkowitz, and I run the Hannah Arendt Center here, and I am pleased to welcome you all to the third and final of our Courage to Be dinner lectures this semester that go along with our Practice of Courage courses that we're having this semester. It's our inaugural semester, our inaugural effort to have a series of courses addressing the question of moral, political, and spiritual courage on campus. I just want to make two quick announcements, and then I'm going to introduce one of our Courage to Be fellows and introduce tonight's speaker. On Monday, May 4th, we'll be having our final Arendt Center event of the year. It's Translating the Holocaust, H.G. Adler as writer and scholar. H.G. Adler was a concentration camp survivor who ended up writing an incredible book on Theresienstadt, one of the model camps, that has never been translated, even though it's been widely cited and used. And it will be finally translated this year, published by the Holocaust Museum and Oxford University Press. And the editor of that volume will be here, in addition to Jeremy Adler, who's a scholar at Cambridge, and the son of H.J. Adler, and some other speakers, including Bill T. Jones, of the Bill T. Jones Dance Company, who has a new dance called Dora Transmontane, which is about his mother-in-law and her work in the concentration camps in France, which will be performed for members of the Courage to Be seminar on May 12th, and I really do encourage you to RSVP for that. It's going to be an extremely interesting evening, and both Bill T. Jones and his mother-in-law, Dora, will be there to answer questions afterwards. So it's not open to the public. It hasn't yet premiered yet, but we're getting a special screening of it. So I do hope you can join us for that. If you haven't yet RSVP'd, please do. And if you have any questions, please email us at arendt@bard.edu. For now, I hope you enjoy dinner. And let me introduce Bethany Zulik, who's a junior here in a philosophy. And she's one of our Courage to Be fellows. And she'll be introducing our speaker tonight. Thank you very much.
Jeanne van Heeswijk is a curator and visual artist. Since the early 90s, she has collaborated with people all over the world to create socially engaged art that is driven by members of those communities. In 2011 in Moscow, she organized a series of living statues depicting marginalized and impoverished members of the community. They were strategically placed near government buildings to serve as a silent testament to the unheard voices of the city. In 2010, she worked with people from the Anfield and Brookfield areas of Liverpool to reclaim and rebuild a vacant block to create affordable housing, a bakery, and meeting spaces for the neighborhood. Then again in 2011, she was awarded the Annenberg Prize for Art and Social Change. And then in 2012, she received the Curry Stone Design Prize. And now she is a Herring Fellow at Bard. My pleasure to introduce.
Thank you, Bethany, for the introduction, Roger, for inviting me, and Tina for bearing with me and moving my date around. So I'm going to talk a little bit about my work in relation to some of the questions asked in the Courage to Be lecture series on practicing courage. I'm very honored to speak here, but I'm also frankly a bit worried because I feel a bit out of my depth. I am not a scholar on the subject, and if I have any knowledge to share with you, it's based in practice. Although reading sometimes informs my practice, most of what I do is what I learn daily on the ground. Over the last 25 years, I have been repeatedly asking myself, how to intervene in a way that people can increase the number and intensities of their ties. How can I work with my skills as an artist within the complexity of our cities and put myself to work in areas that are undergoing rapid change and have huge pressures from the forces of globalization? Trying to assist processes that make these tensions visible and encourage people to become participants in the processes of visualizing the dynamics, complexity, and the diversity of the cities we live in. To test and imagine alliances between politics and art and base them in practices that can establish narratives for a democratic, post-national, inclusive society. A practice that at its base has a continuous learning about what it takes to collectively take responsibility for the place we live. My practice is about to take time to practice, repeat, learn, make mistakes, test again, retake, try again, and work at it again and again and again. And I say it like that because I'm going to take you to some of the projects I've been working on and some of the ideas and some of the questions I encountered. But you also have to bear with me and understand that it's really practicing. It's trying to learn from the conditions of where we are at this moment. So I'll take you first to my sketchbook. The current economic crisis, as well as the shifting of geopolitical boundaries and socio-cultural demographic as a result of global urbanization, has generated numerous local zones of conflict. Many neighborhoods have become sites of contestation into which different conditions of power are inscribed, where everything seems to be locked up by overregulation and where populist images prevail. People are increasingly becoming disinvested and exclusive from their own environment. There is a serious disconnect between ordinary people and their government. To me, the investigative and explorative qualities of the art should serve a process in which we can learn collectively how we can engage and act upon the world in order to renegotiate the conditions of our existence. In order to induce such an engagement, I try to create intermediate spaces within communities, within which any person may speak. And I see the arrangement and rearrangement of space, and here space can be taken very literally, but also metaphorically, space in your heart, space in your head, space to share, as a condition of possibilities for bringing about changes and preferably improvements in social structures. For this, the artistic sanctuary needs to be defined as a mental space where a new moral attitude might be formulated. Such an attitude should embrace the pluriformity of our contemporary society and attempt to escape from mass media relativism and fundamentalism. Sorry for my English. The key concepts underlying such a practice are for me acting, meeting, and communicating. Activities exploring what it takes to be an active citizen and how to engage communities around critical public issues. Questions about publicness, social interaction, and politics are constantly in my reasoning. Asking how can places become public again? Platforms for meeting, discussion, and also conflict. And how to work on self-organization, collective ownership, and new forms of sociality. Sociality is a term introduced by the English sociologist Scott Lesch, in which, in his essay, Difference of Sociality Towards Theory of the Image, and he suggests there, and I quote him here, we can find an escape route through focusing on non-representative forms. By actively creating meaning through dialogue and intersubjective communication, we might be able to find a way out of the productivity system which makes us passive receivers rather than active producers of meaning. For him, the first step is to place our own subjectivity at risk. And I will sort of like go and talk a little bit through some of the projects and talking about the possibility and how to encourage people to actually place their subjectivity at risk, to place the subjectivity in risk in order to encounter the other. And in order to encounter the other, in order to create a common understanding of how we might make decisions about where we are. So, and I said to you, I'll talk a little bit about public faculty, which is my sketchbook. I work on very long-term durational projects, sometimes 10 years, with certain groups and communities on a specific topic. And when you work so long time in communities or in certain neighborhoods, you can easily become stuck in all kind of like daily stuff, politics, fundraising, dealing with people. And in order to practice myself what it means to talk to people and to try to understand how people feel about the place where they are and where they live, I have this sketchbook which I call Public Faculty. Public faculties, like I said, are a sketchbook, and they usually take 4 days, 4 hours each day. It involves standing at a location where there's pressure in a city and speaking to whomever wants to engage into a conversation about the issues at hand. Public faculties are exercised in public conversations with whomever wants to join in. And I learned the hard way that this is very difficult. To just go to stand on a corner and try to engage in a meaningful dialogue with any stranger you encounter. The first public faculty was in an abandoned park in Skopje, Macedonia. And I stood on an abandoned stage-like area, as you can see, and talked to people about who should care about maintaining the park and what would it take for the park to be revived at that moment in time in Skopje, Macedonia. It almost took 2 days for me walking up and down the platform before somebody really wanted to join in the conversations. I was walking the platform up and down all the time, speaking about meaning, the meaning of publicness, the meaning of caring for the park, the meaning of public responsibility, and everybody was just basically staring at me. Till at one point, a woman with white hair came up to me and said, like, "Are you all right, Lloyd?" And this was a very important moment, because from that moment, I opened up, but also more people joined into the conversation. Because I told her, yes, I think I might be all right, but I might need a little help with this. And I actually didn't have any person to join into a conversation. Danny and Ellen, in her book Talking to Strangers, Anxiety of Citizenship Since Brown versus the Board of Education, says it like that, quote, "Don't talk to strangers is the advice long given to children by parents of all classes and races. Today it has blossomed into a fundamental precept of civic education, reflecting interracial distrust, personal and political alienation, and a profound suspicion of others." Ellen writes that democracy originates in the subjective dimension of everyday life, or what she called our habit of citizenship, the ways in which we often unconsciously regard and interact with fellow citizens. She looks at the ordinary, daily sacrifices citizens make to keep democracy working. To Ellen, sacrifice is the key concept for bridging citizenship and trust. Furthermore, she asserts that this entire process relies on the desire to talk with strangers. So for me, like I said, the faculties are about trying to practice talking to members of the general public about pressing public issues. This process of questioning does not bring necessary new answers or solutions to a problem. What is important is the way the people formulate the answers to the questions, or actually rephrase the questions, or dress them up with more questions. This makes me learn how people feel and relate to the conditions they live in, and if they think they have any ownership of the situation. In this instance, in Skopje, Macedonia, the discussion ranged from government responsibility for the park versus people cleaning it themselves, from making it safe to policing, from a place to have a coffee to the danger of communalization. Like very general conversations. But like I said, it's not so much about the answers, but it's about the specific way in which people formulate those answers, because it gives a clear insight in what they do or what they feel they can do themselves to change their daily condition, or where they feel they can take part, or what they think it needs for them to take part, or why they don't take part at all. Public faculties are exercising in learning how to listen to people describing their daily conditions, and how they often feel incapable of changing their condition. An aim is to learn how to make an existing conflict productive, learning to speak and think together about what it would take to be an active citizen, and then demonstrating it in public, in town, to others, share it. Teaching each other what is needed to take responsibility for the place we live. In Copenhagen, for instance, public faculty number 5, we were discussing the economy at a seeming never-ended crisis in perhaps the most inhospitable environment, the main shopping street, where people are adept at avoiding encounters with one another. Our strategy was to announce forcefully that we were harmless. We had a sign saying, we just talked. And like I said, faculties are really about trying to engage into a conversation about a pressing issue. And this was in the time where Denmark was having elections, Denmark around austerity measurements in Europe, and people had to say if they wanted to pay more taxes in relation to level some of the differences that were going on in Europe. So talking about that in the main shopping street where you can buy your Prada and your Chanel and stuff like that is not, as you can imagine, a very favorable topic to do. And first we had a sign and we said, let's talk money. That didn't work at all. But we just talked sort of in one way, sort of like spark interest, because people wanted to know why we just wanted to talk and about what we were just wanted to talk. And if we were wanted to sell something, if we were from a political party, if we were religious, all of these questions. And the fact that we were just wanted to talk seemed to be pretty scary to a lot of people. Our interests were not harmless, however. We think the discussion we begin is anything but harmless. Indeed, it might have been somewhat destructive. But our point is that the only thing more dangerous than beginning to rethink the relationship of economy, public life, social justice would be refrained from doing. The question we are asking is not all simple. How can we have a public life in a situation where strictly defined economic logics seem to saturate all parts of our social and political world? Is there a way to reinvigorate the public sphere in such a way that we are not already from the start assigned certain positions defined by the current neoliberal regime? We think this might be the only way in which we can hope to solve our current political predicament. And this is some of the text that afterwards Rasmus Ublit, one of my collaborators on the project, wrote for the local newspaper. So to explain you a little bit about how faculty work, because they are, like I said, they are a sketchbook in trying to exercise, like talking in public about public issues and about public life. They take always place 4 days and 4 hours, and they always find a way to draw out this conversation in one way or another. Like you saw on the stage, we draw on the wall of the stage, we draw on an old statue, and here we worked actually with signs, because in the main street of shopping street of Copenhagen, there are a lot of people, mostly of Romanian and Bulgarian origin, earning a living by carrying signs with advertisements around the streets, which say things like, today you get a free shampoo if you have a supercut, or free cola when buying a kebab. And I thought that was sort of very interesting, because exactly the people that were sort of embodying the conflict were there on the streets daily, because it's predominantly the austerity measurements were a problem predominantly dealing with the enlargement of Europe with Hungary and Bulgaria. So when I asked them if they would be happy to carry different signs, they said, we are fine with it as long as you pay us the regular fee, or you pay us even more. A number of them also intervened by displaying their own questions about the economy. For example, one girl decided to show and display how much she earned per hour carrying a placard, and that she, in this case, earned a living wage. An older man who had recently lost his job stopped and asked how he could sign up as being one of the carriers, as he could use the money. He thought actually it was pretty decent pay. The result was a lot of people started to ask questions about precarious labor, what we were doing, and joined in the conversation. Apparently, an older white Danish guy carrying a sign saying how much money he makes spark much more conversation than some of the Bulgarian or the Romanian girls and boys on the street. A psychologist came along and told me after speaking with me for an hour and a half that I was not asking the right questions. That if I was wanting to get answers about the economy and public life, I should really find a way to rephrase my question. And although I explained to him that it was not about finding the answer, he insisted on assisting us and subsequently wrote a lengthy report about how to ask the right question. I think for us that has been sort of like very important that he was there to assure us that we would have an outcome of this project. So understanding that just the bare fact of engaging into the conversation was the main outcome, that there was no other outcome for this exercise, to him was completely lost. And I'll read you one excerpt from the booklet that came out of it, which is called We Just Talks, Reflection on Economy and Public Life by Erasmus. We just talked. Talk is cheap, they say, but they are lying. Talks cost you dearly. It sucks out your very soul. Trying to talk on the street one day, and trying to talk to people on the street one day, and talk with her about something crucial, like the economy. You will be surprised or you will be not. Most people are very much aware of the price of speech. Thus they kindly refuse our offer. We do not blame them. Nothing would be easier than falling into the trap of lamenting the loss of seriousness in public life, to say the public sphere is declining. But this is not a time for remorse. Instead, it is a call for something we believe to be necessary, a renewed insistence upon public discourse. We wish to defend the idea of a public life that cannot be subsumed to whatever idea or products that seem to be marketable at any given moment. To question what is public life. So let's talk. Like I said, public faculty is my sketchbook in this process. It is an important exercise for practicing the skills of conversation and ways of engagement. And also practicing to hold a conversation a little bit longer than the presumed answers of not yet asked questions or preferable outcomes that you might desire, but really exercise to hold a conversation maybe for an hour with somebody you disagree on, or who has a completely different opinion, a completely other side of the spectrum than yourself. It's also a lesson in humility, is to learn to basically withhold also your own judgment in order to listen to somebody else's way of describing the situation. So why do I think it's so important to practice this kind of conversation? Everywhere you see that more and more people feel left out, excluded from the way that their daily environment is shaped, formed, and governed. To be capable to give form to your daily environment, the place where you are, to be capable of understanding the process of imagining, narrating, and legislation is very important in order to be an active citizen. We need to assist people with the skills we have to understand better the different conditions of power inscribed in their neighborhoods, so that they can become a shaping force in their own environment, reclaiming the right to their daily living conditions and having a say in the way the future is formed and financed. So they have the courage to face their world in progress, not as consumers, but to become actors in their own surroundings, being able to act up, being able to be an active citizens, to be able to be agents of change. For this, an entry point for the latent potential of the specific condition of the local to emerge needs to be found and a response needs to be activated. This looping of action and reaction is the basis on which to activate the local and to use local inhabitants' specific knowledge to become agents of change in that place. Often I see that new forms of commonality, of co-production, come into being to setting up change of productions of locality. This can be through singing, discussing, gardening, to a lot of different activities, or just by talking. But it is about common production and the creating chains of collective production. And to tell you a little bit how that works in one project and in another project, I take you to two projects. One that I worked on for a year and that continued for another 4 years, which is in Wertacker, the Ruhrgebiet, and it was called Die Widerstand des kleinen Glücks. It's nicer in German than it is in English, The Resistance of Small Happiness. And the other one I will talk about, the one that was referred to, the two up-to-down home-baked project. So, The Resistance of Small Happiness took place in Wertacker in the Ruhrgebiet. And it's a very little village. It's a very bad picture, sorry, sometimes it happens like that. This village is a very small enclave-like village, which is located directly in the center of the flyovers, viaduct, and multiple level intersections of the A40 and A3 motorways, which together form the Kaiserberg Junction. And this is the biggest autobahn junction or the biggest highway junction in Germany, in the Ruhrgebiet, which is the industrial area of Germany. And this little village is very particularly because there is a lot of work done at the moment to reconfigure the Ruhrgebiet from a post-industrial area to something that is maybe more part of this time. You know, Krupp steel industry, all the biggest industries are there. Most of the mining industry is there. And in 2010. It was part of the European policy. You will hear more about European slogan about making this a creative metropole. The whole reason changing it from its industrial part into a creative metropole area. And a lot of money was thrown at it. And this little village, basically consisting of a few hundred houses, basically didn't want to go along very much with all these new ideas for the area. So let me explain you a little bit about the village. So in this village, here in the middle of the junctions, the local residents, in obvious reaction to the noisy environment, make ample use of goods offered by DIY superstores and garden centers to create miniature oases in a brave attempt to maintain the social identity of the village in an area that is characterized by an amenity of the surrounding infrastructure. An area, moreover, where the aging population is an ever-present issue and where newcomers do not always share the same background. The village main landmarks are one bunker, which is used as a rehearsal room by hard rock bands who are not overly welcomed by the residents, and an abandoned church. And this all takes place in the abandoned church. Since early 2006, the preservation of the St. Martinus Chapel in Wertacker has been a major topic public debate. The church at Wertacker is not only the central architectural feature of the village, but simultaneously served as the local community center after it was abandoned and desecularized by the diocese. The building underwent various modes of utilization. For the villagers, the fact that it accommodates the Siedler Clauses, which is a sort of space, settlements, was probably the most important aspect of its use. Situated in the basement of the chapel, the settlement basement is a meeting point for the community. It's also the unofficial village hall, and even serves as the local pub, since the church decided to demolish their former place of workshop. This community center was doomed also as a place which provided a sense of identity to the village. And like I said, they meet there every Wednesday to discuss the state of affair of their little village. And as you can see, these are predominantly men discussing where the village is going, because it's a settlement, so it has an own mayor, an own appointed mayor. And they were thinking, like, how can we deal with this church and the fact that they want to demolish the church, and that we will lose on top of that not only a place to come together, but also we will use our pub, our local pub. We will lose and our city hall and our pub and our community center all at once at the same time. So they came up with actually quite a good and smart idea, because I always said if you work with people, people themselves have quite interesting idea how to basically fight the powers to be. So they came up with an idea which was as simple as half a church, not a church. So they came up with the idea, what if we cut the church in half after it's desegregated, then it's not anymore a church. So then we could maybe use it again as a community center and maybe also as a pub. So they wrote long, long letters in very eloquent High Deutsch to the church, but with almost no result. Because the way they communicated was along long lines of bureaucracy and long lines of trying to advocate for it. So when I met them for the first time was around this time, and I basically decided to sort of like support them in their struggle. Because I think one of the things that was sort of like important about the struggle is that although they engaged with the church and with the people of the city, they actually didn't, they used, let's say, lines through writing letters and to speaking to the counselor and stuff like that, but they didn't make it into a public issue. They didn't actually took it outside and made it something of a public concern, try to speak about it like with other members of the community and of the community at large. So basically what I did then during the time they were demolishing part of the church, I gave them a very, very, very big table. It's a horseshoe-like table that was big enough to seat the whole village for the duration of the summer in which this whole process of transition was going to take place. And this table for the whole duration of the summer would stand in front of the church, which was partly going to be demolished, and it served as a town hall, as a meeting place, as a podium, but also as a beer garden and as a grill place for that. And people that maybe recognize a horse-shaped table, when I met the villagers for the first time, they made me think of Asterix and Obelix. And in their fight, like the little village, sort of like not only fighting time, but also fighting their own existence and their own maybe identity that sort of was a little bit awkward. So that's why they got a big table, but also because for them, talking and discussing issues of public matter went hand in hand with drinking beer and grilled sausages. There was almost hardly any escape of it. So I proposed them this table for the summer to publicize basically their struggles. And under the title, Lass die Kirche im Dorf, let the church stay in the village. That's what it means in German, but there is also a colloquial way in German to say Lass die Kirche im Dorf, that say let it be, let it happen, let it be as it is, let us be as we are. And I think that became very much part of the continuous thing that happened. Because of the table and because of the fact they took all their meetings outside in public, it just started to draw attention from people from afar that came not only to have a beer and a grilled sausage with them, but to sit down with them on the table and to engage about these discussions about what it takes for a village like that to be part of all the changing plans of the area. And this is the mayor talking to people about some of the issues. And they sort of started to take more and more ownership of it. They started to generate additional events and started to use the table also as a podium because it apparently it was strong enough to dance on, as we figured out after a lot of beer. And they started to make t-shirts and stuff like that, saying like, wir sind das Ruhrgebiet. We are the Ruhrgebiet. Maybe you don't like it, but you have to take us into account when you make plans about our future. And I think that was sort of very, very much. And they started to be very vocal about it, started to speak about it, started to advocate about it. And because more and more people started in, the story sort of started spreading. And you will see that a lot in the work, is that the spreading of the story when people claim a public position is very, very important. So from asphalt cowboys to rural galliers, the church stays in Dorf, and the struggle or the Kampfgeist liked in Dorf. And this started to sort of like draw attention also from local and also international and national government about the struggle of this village, not only about their church or their half church, but about a proper way to understand their identity as a village and their struggle with their identity in a changing world, and how to take that into account of some of the conversations. So, I think I have a quote here of Arendt, although I find it almost terrible to quote in a situation like that, but I think when Arendt described the web of relationship and the enacted stories that can be as follows. Action and speech go on between men as they are directed towards them, and they retain their agent-revealing capacity, even in their content is exclusively concerned with specific objective worldly interest. These interests constitute in the world most literally significance, something which interest being in between, which lies between people and therefore can relate and bind them together. It's because of this already existing web of human relationship, which is innumerable conflicting wills and intentions, that action almost never achieves its purpose. But it's also because of this medium that it produces story with or without intention. And I think that is sort of like what I think that when she links action and speech to her central to a characterization of powers, which is the potential which springs up between people when they act in concert. And this idea of acting in concert, trying to find a way that despite different way to act in concert and speak out together, is something that I think is very important for people to understand and to learn, to practice what does that mean, to act in concert. For me, I think this needs a lot of practice, as I said. It means quite often working long-term with groups to basically take matters into our own hands, to understand what it takes to speak up, to hold a conversation, to publicize it, but also to act in concert in order to work together on the situation at hand. What it means for me is that I have to become quite often part of the community, or being part of the whole process of change a neighborhood is undergoing is key. And one of the strategies that is very important for me is to immerse myself in a specific situation and simulate a set of questions that generate interaction between the people involved. And for this, what I call a field of interaction has to be created. And fields of interactions to me are temporary territories to play with, confront, and discuss in. For this, a set of questions that circumscribe particular proper dimensions or tensions have to be defined. And to define the questions that circumscribe the field is already a process that has to come from a specific circumstance of a location and from the people involved. And I see people that are involved, I see them as, I call them experts on locations. Because to me, they are people who have knowledge of a place because they live there or work there, or that they carry a certain knowledge that might be needed for that specific place. And I think these experts are the entry point in order to understand the latent potential of a specific condition and to activate a response. I think it's also up to them to actually activate a response to what it is to have a public life, a public appearance. Their questions define a field of interaction that can empower local inhabitants to use their specific knowledge to become agents of change. Through their interaction with others, confrontation and eventually conflict, ultimately a movement starts happening. And if a movement starts happening, change starts happening. Becoming part of the action-reaction, part of the conflict, and being submissive to anything you can learn, and being reactive to anything a person wants to bestow upon you and wants to teach you, even with things that you think are unnecessary to learn in order to move towards the interaction process that is needed to get things moving. In this way, things emerge from the local condition and people taking positions in a process. For this, it's important to let go of any grip and to wait for the spatial and emotional conditions to emerge. You have to let go within, you have to let go of your own subjectivity. When we all attempt to lose our subjectivity, it's at least partly the preconditions for generating something between us that is actually an agent of change. And for this, I think we need to establish places where people teach each other what it takes to become an active citizen, and where they do take collective responsibility to produce changes in order to make the processes work in a larger social political context. It is actually here that we have to learn to deepen and sharpen and question our narratives in order to collectively take responsibility for the places we are in. So for me, I think it's very important when I talk about an engaged practice is to ask how an engaged practice will not only address issues through debates, but can at the same time mobilize existing local, physical and socio-cultural capital and use it as a performative basis for a city under involvement. And here the performative, because I talk about being an actor in your own surrounding, being able to act up, act out, be an active citizen, and I see that as performative actions. Here the performative should be understood as a way to try to decolonize space, as a performative gesture or intervention that tries to create a space for the confrontation of diversity of individual projectors in order to create a different image of the city. And I want to take you to Anfield in Liverpool, which is home-baked, or the 2-2-2-baked project for which I am now working already for the last 4 or 5 years, and it looks like it will continue a little bit longer. And this is also the last project I will describe, and some of the conditions we are talking about. So I'd like to quote here a quote of David Harvard, if we talk about a different way of the image of the city. The city we want cannot be divorced from what kind of people we want to be. What kind of social? What relation to nature we cherish, what style of life we want, and what aesthetic values we hold. The right to the city is therefore far more than a right of individual or group access to the resources the city embodies. It's a right to change and reinvent the city more after our heart's desire, and I like that very much, after our heart's desire. It is moreover a collective rather than an individual right, since reinventing the city inevitably depends on the exercise of a collective power over the processes of urbanization. The freedom to make and remake ourselves and our city is, he argues, one of the most precious yet most neglected of our human rights. And how can we then best exercise that right? And I think one of the most pressing issues in most of the situations I've been working over the last years is that one of housing and affordable housing. So housing for me is the battlefield of our time, and perhaps an affordable house is its monument. And to me, housing is not a product, but it's a process. And the question is, how can we make that in a process that is inclusive? So how can we find strategies and micropolitic tactics that to inhabit this process collectively? And as you see, I talk about the city, but this can also be a rural situation. I think I like to talk about the place we live or the place we share or the neighborhood, or if that's a small village in the middle of a highway, or if it's Anfield in Liverpool. I think it's important to see them as places where we try, as the local, where we try to have to figure out how to build it collectively true in relation to our heart's desire. So Anfield. For those who know Anfield or might not know Anfield, it's very famous for its football club, the Liverpool football club of Anfield. But it's also an area that fell victim to a very failed government scheme called Housing Market Renewal Initiative. The initiative was originally intended to get money flowing through 9 areas of North England, places identified as market failures, where unlike any other part of Britain, housing prices had stagnated. In the Enfield-Breckfield area alone, several thousand homes have been emptied in order to build new housing estates. Many people who owned a terrace house outright now couldn't afford a new home with the compensation paid by the city and were forced into debt for rental property. Market, as some of the members of the community said, was the key idea here, not community renewal. And this is just a picture of Anfield football stadium, and this is the area which was scheduled for complete demolition. Basically, the idea of the scheme was that the whole of Anfield would be demolished in order to build new houses. It's a working class area, and families were forced to sell their houses, many of which had lived there for generations. Through a compulsory purchase order, you say here through eminent domain, I think, from the city. Most people only received a maximum of $60,000 compensation for their house, whereas a new house in the same size in the new area would cost $90,000. With high unemployment rates in the area, this meant that many people could not afford a mortgage and did not know where to go. In addition to that, the developer, who was supposed to build all the new houses, had halted the work in 2010 with the onset of the global financial crisis. As a result, there were empty fields where 1,500 buildings have been demolished, others standing partly boarded up, and about 80 new houses arrived. And then the whole scheme shut down. Angela McKay, local resident and social worker, stated, "The local community has had their hope repeatedly raised and dashed by promises of neighborhood regeneration, which has been slow to materialize. After 15 years of living under these circumstances, many people have lost trust in any government scheme. We are sick of waiting for something to be delivered. It is the numbers of times we have been made promises and have been made lied to. To me, housing market renewal initiative means devastation, promises broken, no consultations. We are sick of waiting for something to happen, sick of waiting for some kind of promise to be delivered or a glimpse of what our future might hold." This being sick of the waiting, she describes as an urban condition, a human condition, a condition about not having a say in the way your living conditions are formed. And for me, that sort of was the start of thinking about how to work on this project and work on some kind of a temporary intervention. And sometimes, like I said, like going to stand on the street and talk to people about a certain thing. Some of my methods are very simple, or just offering a big table in order to create a town hall situation and to do it in public, so in order to publicize it. In this case, I very simply thought maybe one of the things to do in this situation is to stop waiting and start making. It's very simple, but that sort of was my outset. And that was my proposition, is that why don't we just take over some of the empty properties, and why don't we start making again some of our own daily situation? Why do we not start making again our own livelihood? I'll give you Jeanne very quickly, because I think she can describe the condition very well, and I think it's a beautiful way of saying it. She has a very heavy Scouse accent, which is maybe different than a Dutch accent, but bear with.
So what ends up happening is we all know that it was a controlled decline, and that was the sad point, because my mum and dad had worked hard all alive, you know what I mean? They were paying a mortgage, and they were 5 years from finishing it. And they were basically put in a situation where nobody, who's going to buy it? So they were forced into selling, and the money that they got for it was so small, they were then forced to take out another mortgage. And the best bit is the council gave them a loan, £30,000, which the best part is that they have to pay back after they're dead, which in fact means me and my two brothers will pay it back. And to me, that is the absolute killer. It should have been 30 grand compensation for being subjected to this, do you know what I mean? Because they had no choice. Because who was going to buy it apart from the council? No one's going to buy it. So they took 10 years to basically bring the street to its knees. and there was nothing wrong with it. There wasn't a single empty. We all played out. As far as I'm concerned, there was no trouble. There was no bother. So we just watched it, and from what I understand and how I figure it, it's just a very simple thing that it's about money, and there was a big pot of gold to the European Union, and in order to access that pot, the area had to tick so many boxes in the magical world of deprivation. So suddenly we were being told all the time that we were from this deprived area, and we were like, I'm not deprived. I don't feel deprived. But we've all got food, we've all got clothes, both parents work. How am I deprived? But the more you feed that in, you pour, you dish that and the other, it's almost like you just watch the standards drop. And everything seemed to drop. And it took about 10 years, but they finally obviously ticked that last box that they needed to tick. And that was that then.
So like I said, the initial idea from which we started was very simple. To counteract the sickness was to start making and to ask, how can we start producing our food, future, our daily environment together? How can we collectively create conditions of livability? How would an alternative to this situation look? We sort of set up camp in this block of houses, which was a recently closed bakery on the corner of the red-lined area, waiting for demolition. The family bakery was one of the last places still open in the area. It had been there for 60 years and had been forced to close by the threat of demolition. They were waiting for the government compensation, which did not eventuate. It was an important place for the community, offering fresh food and facing the football stadium. We rented it from the family and set up an independent community workspace here. And like with the table in the village hall, this place, this bakery, which was actually a sort of informal gathering space for the community, we turned it into a more public and a more official gathering place for the community. For a period of the years, a group of young people were taking the community as their client, and they worked with architects to remodel the building into a bakery with a training kitchen and a housing scheme for 2 to 4 families, developing a deeper understanding of the need for the community and acquire new skills. Later, the bakery also reopened as a community-run business. And these were some of the sessions where young people really learned about what this condition of building actually means and what it means to have a say in that. And it's also basically learning about it very skill. The bakery, which was closed down, we started to use to run discussions about refactoring houses in an eco-friendly way, interest instead of constructing new buildings, taking on models for community ownership through the workshop, and we started to slowly build a community again, which had been fragmented and isolated. And I think this was also very important in Bertakker, that through opening of this place and through actually setting it down and discussing these conditions of the community in public with the public, you not only start a public debate, but you also start to build a new community again. To Up to Down, Home Baked, aimed to create a new model of people-centered, community-owned regeneration of Enfield. It wants to offer a viable alternative to the stalled top-down initiative that have left the area desolate, lacking in amenities or work opportunities and without a social center. Home Baked proposes a small footprint that combines affordable housing with social space, green space and enterprise in a collective community ownership, allowing people to take matters back into their own hands regarding the future of their neighborhood. So, what was very important, that this bakery was not a bakery when it was a closed down bakery when we started to work there, and it functioned predominantly as a discussion place to discuss the conditions of the area. But every time we were there, somebody would open the door and said, like, do you sell bread? Do you have cakes? And then one of the persons said, like, yeah, no, but you can have a cup of coffee, sit down. And then one of the other days, Sue, one of the members, she brought cake. She baked cake at home, and she said, like, now if somebody comes, they can ask, they can get a coffee with a cake. And then the next time, another person brought another cake. And the next time another person brought another cake. And before we know, most of the discussions were about cake, I have to say. And I have to say, because I lamented that, because it sort of like drifted sometimes a bit of the discussion away around what we were doing. But it also sparked a desire for people to reopen the bakery, to not only talk and discuss about what is needed and to start rebuilding maybe some of the housing, but also to start rebuilding that specific place as a community-owned and a community-run business. So we went through a very steep learning curve about what it means to as a community to own land through a land trust, what it means to run a cooperative business as a community, what it really means to produce that kind of like small-scale alternative together. And we had very good slogans that we were putting out, brick by brick, loaf by loaf, we build out ourselves, we will rise. The bread metaphor is amazing. You can do a lot of things with that. So Don Mitchell says in an article that urban activists and urban scholars have long known that it's vitally important to understand how space is produced in capitalism. But more and more, we're coming to understand the vital importance of collectively taking space and making it ours, of differentiating space and making it useful, of stopping in its tracks the tendencies towards abstraction of space, and instead making spaces in which to make life in ways not just dedicated by the crazy inhuman logic of capital development. And I have to say that in the beginning, like I said, most people in the area thought we were snotty, that I was a snotty artist. Who would only also offer empty promises where real action was needed. But I think that through actually the cake, as I say it, turned out to be a very, and bread in general, turned to be a very helpful element to start discussing this notion about livelihood and about what this means to live together. And like I said, we have a community land trust and a cooperative bakery that is running now, because as some people said, home bake, that is sort of like what the title became. They understood it as to be the perfect recipe. And we first started to, like, people bringing some cakes, which I said it really turned into like a big feast. And then more and more people came, and more people started to talk about this necessity for the bakery to be open. And in 2012, we opened the bakery again as a community bakery and cafe, and it opened from Mondays to Fridays and Saturdays, as you can say, trying to provide again food for the community. And this was exactly the moment where a lot of things shifted in the project. Not only was the bakery open, not only were we producing stuff again, but this was also the moment where the city decided to enforce its eminent domain. Because all the time we were still under eminent domain, we were still in the red light zone, where they just basically said, sorry, very nice you did all of that, but we're going to demolish anyway. And this was a moment where we, and you will see that these kind of things in my work are very important to find also not only ways for people to gather and to gather around a specific topic that they feel that they can produce together, if it's in this case bread, but to also find ways to publicize it. And we used the biennial, the Liverpool Biennial and Art Festival, to create what we call the Enfield Home Tour. And it was also interesting because the biennial was one of the co-commissioners of this project, and at some point after 3 years working along the line, I think some of the board of the biennial basically said, like, why is this art still around? But basically, what has affordable housing actually to do with art? And although I very much advocated to him that housing is the battlefield of our time, and that affordable housing you could see as a monument, so that this bakery would be a form of monumental art, it wasn't completely convincing. And they said, like, we need you maybe to step up a little bit on that realm. So the Enfield Home Tours for us were a way to talk about the project. And we run them from September to November 2012. And what they basically did is they gave local people a stage to voice their feelings on the city regeneration scheme and their visions of a collective future. The heritage tours, because they were heritage tours, conducted by and with Enfield residents by a local theater director comprised of a bus ride from the biennial main exhibition venue through the landscape of slum clearances in Liverpool. And that's a whole history, because Liverpool had a whole history of slum clearances and of like sort of like pushing, as they call, undesirable communities out of the city. And while you were traveling through this sort of like narrative, this performative narrative, different residents would ride on the bus, or you would get out into one of their houses, and they would explain in their individual ways how they had or had not coped with the redevelopment through stories, poetry, and music. And the event accumulated at the bakery, where the visitors could talk with people from the community they had met on the tour. So while you were doing on the tour and you met somebody on the bus who would explain what it means, you would hear Jane talking her story. You would meet those people. You would visit Sue in her house, who would bake you a cake. She would explain what it means for her. And then when you came to the bakery, all these people came there, and you would find them all there to sit down with them and to have a cup of coffee and to go over all the experience, but also to go over all of these things. So everybody all the local residents enjoyed doing them, but it also distracted from the actual work that the bakery getting the bakery running and lobbying for the bakery and the surrounding properties not to be demolished, but to be sold to community land trust. Yet the performative tours were very important because it empowered the community to take a political stance. It was the moment where the project became really political. They became advocates of the project, speaking to everybody about it. And Fred Brown, a local arts and activist, would say it like that. This is Fred Brown. As in all baking, so it also should be with developing an idea. Decide what it is you want to make, gather materials, including people, do some forensic work in preparation, then wait. Then do something more forensic activities, then wait again. Then apply the required heat. Taking the time it needs is a recognized and vital part of the baking process to produce the best result. In project development, it can be so frustrating as we wait on results, but it needs to be done. The time needs to be taken. Give it the time, give it the resource, and try not to prescribe. We nurture each other as though we arise. And I think it's sort of like the same, what I've been saying about how I see practice and the fact of practicing it, and he describes it in maybe in a way. And as with Werther, I could also hear the story went completely viral. Up to the New York Times and the Guardian and everywhere around the world, writers commented on the struggle of the home-baked community. It was bittersweet, because like I said, it overshadowed the messy chaos and systematic imbalance the project had to navigate to every day. And it was very important for the community to stand up and to take that stance, but then again, it overshadowed the work on the ground. And Ultra Red, artist collective, refer to this systematic imbalance. It's not just about changing our perspective, our world. It's changing the world we perceive. In fact, we must do both, changing perception and the world as one follows the other. And like I said, we are at the moment, we are a full running business. We are preparing to build more houses, and the community fundraised for its own equipment. They've been looking for more money to also develop the rest of the block, but like I said, like the demolition order still stands. And at present, we are still, 2 years later, still, although we did the flats, we have like two affordable houses upstairs, the bakery, and one next door, we still didn't manage to lift the demolition order of the building. And the bakery's up and running, it foods, it serves the community again, it builds the whole community again. We have investors that will help to build us another 80 affordable houses next door. We have the permission of the land in the back to use it as a growing ground, but we still have the eminent domain, which seems to be impossible to lift. This is not a very happy story, the community keeps fighting, but it's also been very hard for the community to keep the trust in the fact that this struggle will be a valuable, will be one that we can win. So we face an ongoing battle for the right to live and work well. After long negotiations, we agreed with the council that we might, if we come up with a new housing scheme that incorporates the bakery, and that it will look like nothing else before, we have only, they said they might allow us to keep the bakery as incorporated in a new build scheme. But on top of that, they said we only gave us 18 months to create a business plan or a plan of merit for these new affordable houses, including the complete finances, which requires around a few million pounds. So they say, thank you very much. You know, you cannot, we won't demolish the building if you incorporate it in a new structure, and it will be unrecognizable as the old one. But you, on top of that, has to fulfill a scheme of merit of affordable houses and do that within 18 months and find the required money for that. So I think I tell you this because the struggles are continuous. It is not only about trying to find the political stance, trying to find your feet again as a community, trying to renegotiate a different understanding of what you need to move on. It is also a struggle that's never ending. That is like again and again and again and again. And I'm rounding up with that because what's been most affecting in this project is the way people kept fighting and the courage they had after being bogged down again and again. This step by step, took over from the biennial, ran a Kickstarter campaign to fund the bakery, kept talking about it on radio, TV, and to the housing minister and the council, saying, we have taken matters into our own hands. We have to be reckoned with. We are the future of Anfield, and we know how to manage land, run a business, and relate to our neighbors. We know what it is to be a community again. And we will rise, as there's plenty more of us than you here. And in a reflection on Jasper's about the manner in which there can be participation to the public domain, Hannah Arendt said, and it's one of the quotes that I always carried with me as an artist, and I will say it in German before and then in my crappy English translation. Nur wir sein Leben und seine Person nicht in das Wagnis der Öffentlichkeit nimmt, kann sie erreichen. So, freely translated, only when one takes a risk in public with both his life in person can one enrich it. For me, practicing courage means placing your subjectivity at risk in order to find ways to collectively create public value, reset its public faculty as a contribution to greater solidarity. And like Fred said, for this we need to continuously go back again and again to create an understanding of the public as a shared space, a space that everybody can and has the right to contribute and change. And I leave you with a song that is made by some of the people of the community, and it says, we will rise, as there is plenty more of us than you there.
Can we meet your blood with kindness? Can we meet your hate with love? Can we keep our years of silence as you crush us from above? As the judgment day draws closer, as the reckoning draws near, there's plenty more of us than you here. And mark my words, we will rise. Mark my words. Mark my words, we will rise. As you crush us from above, there's Mark my words, we will rise. Mark my words, we will rise. Spread our wings like birds and lay down from the skies. Mark my words, we will rise.
You're like the monastic presence going from project to project, and you are an ambulatory example to all of us. Thank you.
Do you want to comment?
I think that, thank you very much, but that feels like too much. I think
I don't care. That is really.
I think it's very important, I hope to send that it is something that I think that we all need to sort of like be reminded of, that we all have the courage to be, and that we all have to find a way to find a way that we can stand up and speak out. And I think in these processes, I think it is sometimes it's very, I find it very heartwarming, like when a person like Fred starts actually taking the courage to not only participate in the project but also stand up, speak out, and carry the project, and by that, let's say, some of the changes in his own neighborhood. So I think I feel myself more. I think I once described it like not as Don Quixote, but as Sancho Pancho, the one that sort of like is the one who guides or helps to assist. Maybe the possibility of a fight against, let's say, windmills, or a fight against the impossible. But so not be the fighter, but be the one that might help to assist the fight.
If I can just add something, I mean, Sancho is always desperate for food, and Don Quixote is the one who says, I don't need food because there's no food in chivalric romances. But it seems to me that and I'm thinking of myself here, I could never give up certain pleasures. I could never give up a kind of sedentary experience. And it seems that you go from site to site, and you have to give up your comforts and your communities for always looking for a new one.
Well, I always eat food.
But how do you give up so much?
I think because I mean I have to say, like, for me it's like it's a pleasure. Like, I learn a lot. I see, that's why I try the same thing. I see my practice as a constant learning, and that's what I do. I see it as a practice, to practice and to learn from wherever I go. So I get, in that sense, I get a lot because I learn from every person and from every encounter and from every project. And it's also in these moments and where you also see, like for an Enfield, there's also joy to see a group of people standing up, and I learned a lot from them. I learned where in the beginning, I wouldn't want to be found that as an artist, saying that I finally only created cake. You know, I'm very honest. Like, I still remember that I said in one of the meetings, I said, over my dead body, this project is going to be about pink cakes or about cupcakes, you know. Sort of like, you know, I didn't find that cool. And then they explained me, or not they explained me, because they didn't have to explain it to me, but through the project, they learned me that, you know, there are different means to an end, and there are different ways of starting the conversation, and that in this case, this turned out to be very meaningful tool in the conversation. So I have to sometimes also, you know, I have to sometimes also acknowledge my own pre-assumptions, not only my own privileges, but also my own pre-assumptions about what it actually is that is needed, and how to go about that. So that's why my sketchbook, my faculties are really an exercise in that, trying to listen and to engage without necessarily already judging or already thinking about an answer or about an outcome, whatever, or a desire, or even desiring an outcome.
Where do you see the place of artistic intervention or the artistic process in developing a communal voice? That is to say, are there alternatives, alternative mediums for developing that voice, or is it integral to the process?
I think for me it's integral to the process, but it has to do with the fact that I think the way I think about it is that aesthetics is very important in its relation to ethics and to the political, and that the fact that the fact that you can imagine the place where you are, that you can imagine it or narrate it or even face it, this is for this you need an understanding of this kind of processes, and I don't believe like everybody's an artist, like Boyce said, but I believe that this, let's say, creative process is something that can be part of all of us and that we all need in order to understand our daily condition, so, or our human condition, if you want. So it's processes that we have been not only neglected, but that the powers to be forced to neglect. It's also why, for instance, the media is bombarding us ways how to view our condition. So to take that back and to make that again from ourselves something that we can sort of like use, and also use in negotiation or use in negotiation with each other. That's very important. For me, that's very important. I hope that gives you
a better
answer.
Your work really focuses a lot on active engagement.
Stand up so we can hear.
Your work really focuses on active engagement, citizenship. And this is kind of a deceptively simple question, but like, what is community to you? Like, and what have you found this community through your work?
Yeah, the A question is art, the B is for behavior, and C for community, I would say. I have to say I don't think so much about community. I find it a very difficult word because like a neighborhood quite often consists out of a multiplicity of communities. You know, communities quite often seen as clubs and things like that, of like-minded people with a certain interest. So if I think about space, that of people together, I think about the local much more, about the local as a condition in which both, let's say, global issues are inscribed into local specificities, and this condition is let's say, something that's inhabited by people, and these people I see as experts of their location. That's why I call them experts, and because they have knowledge of what it means to reside in that space. That does not necessarily make them a community. Because like in
Anfield, although this was a very strong community, maybe in the 70s and the 80s, as a working class community, through all the years of let's say, the processes of renewal there, the community was completely, you know, fragmented and displaced and segregated. And so there it was actually, is there, again, some common ground we can build? So there the sense of community was about building again common ground. You know, and for instance, in another area where I work for over 12 years now, we have like multiplicity of communities from different religious and cultural and ethnic backgrounds. So they are a multiplicity of communities, and how can this multiplicity still find a common ground? And for me that has to do with how that they can find out how to live together. And for me, I would normally say that the scale of a neighborhood is a scale to talk about. So I think that answers some question about the thing of community, because it's very hard to talk about community in the sense of like, you know, oh, there's the, you know, Latin American community. So for me, it's about more that, about what we might have in common, in commonality. So I take community from there. So that also makes it a little bit different about citizenship, because I see it really about an active act of acting up in your own surroundings. I don't necessarily see it as citizenship in voting, or as in citizenship as in a way to engage in a direct political process. I see it really about redefining the local condition. And I quite often talk about that if I talk about radicalizing the local. And I see that in a way as radicalizing the local in its two sort of like meanings of the word, like as in radical and making more emergent, so making it emerge, while at the same time rerooted. So this is a sort of exercise of emergent and rerooting at the same time within a local condition that to me can form community, if you want, or can shape community. Very short.
I am also interested in this question of community and local activism. The one thing holding me back from sort of doing, working on projects like, say, the bakery, I've happened across things like that, but I haven't really gone towards them, is because it seems kind of like a paradox, actually, for an international student, someone from New York or California, to go across the world and to help local grassroots communities. Because it seems like if we really want to help communities sustain themselves, they have to do that by themselves, and to have international people come in and help them. Wouldn't that make them more dependent on the globalized urban world? And how do you reconcile the paradox between the helper being international, but the problem being local?
Yeah, the missionary pursuit. Yeah, that's what I said. The way I think about the local is that I don't see it, I see it as a condition that has both global, that is both the global problematics as well as local specificity. So if I talk about experts on location, then it can be because you live there, but also maybe because you have certain knowledge that resides in that place or that's needed for that place. So I don't necessarily think you have to live there to be somebody that can be part of the local condition or of the local community. For instance, with the bakery project, one of the first jobs that became available in this project, and everybody there with the high employment was dying for a job, was a baker. Now, there was no baker to be found in the whole Anfield. There was just nobody here, so we had to import the baker. But the baker is a very important person in this forming of this new community. So I think about working together as experts on location, sharing knowledge, learning from each other what it means also that you sometimes have to bring in outside knowledge as it can help the struggle on the ground. So it's not an international expert coming in to do good, but these are processes in which we learn together what it takes to build. And it's also quite often why people say to me, like, so when do you know when to go?
I always say I know when to go, because it's the moment where people don't say, hey, thank you, but when they say thanks. And that's a sort of like a different way. Thanks means, you know, we really appreciate you. But, you know, at this moment in time, you're not the most needed person in this project. You're not, your expertise, your knowledge, your being, is not that what we need. We need other things. But please stick around if you want. Feel welcome, you know? And I think in a process like the process of home day, that's a rotation position. The position of those who take the lead or who are the one who are the one who push and pull. So in that sense, these are processes in which you collectively learn what is needed to build, again, some form of commonality or to find common ground. So it's not somebody coming in trying to do good. So that's what I mean to make emergent while at the same time rerouting. This is not a process one person can lead or hold. That's a process that you have to hold together. And that together you have to build. That's not something that just comes because you say, oh, let's come and do something together. It does not work. I hope that answers your question. The only thing is you have to also dare to risk the fact that your being there might be useless, or might be non-instrumental, or maybe even disruptive in the situation. So you have to handle your own desire. In that sense, we have to maybe not only handle your own desire, but dare to risk it in order for a collective common to build. And I think that's what Harvey means when he says to build the city towards our own desires. He means that that is not an individual desire, but it's a collective desire. It's a collective process. So how to do that? How to reconcile individual desire or individual attempt or individual courage towards a collective common understanding? Because that might not be the same. Might not be appreciated.
Especially in your bakery project, your kind of end result, you know, what really brought you, you got money at the end, right, to build houses.
No, I'm still looking.
I still
need to find $5.5 million.
Oh, no problem.
Somebody has a check.
right.
Or we have to find, not me.
In the interest of that, your main source of income is to appeal to charity. And that, I mean, that's the effect that you're looking for. Do you think that's an essential part of this community-oriented effort, or do you think that it can be internalized and just community-driven without charity?
I don't know why you thought the idea that there's charity involved.
There's no charity?
No.
I mean, the New York Times and the Global Publicity, this spotlight, international appeal, and the videos you make, what is the goal of those besides the spotlight? Is it for the community-driven conversation to exist only, or?
You mean they sell. These things work slightly different. I mean, I was originally asked as an artist to work in Liverpool. That was true. So part of the start of the project was because I got a small grant to be there. But the project itself, basically, we have a running business, a bakery business, which sells bread and cakes and stuff, which also is a independent, running, community-owned business, which is very important. And for the rest, let's say the project, like the land trust we have, that is the ownership of the land. They are looking at the moment, for instance, to take a loan because we have the ownership of the land to use it as an equity to get a loan to build it for them houses. And in the project itself, people are working on a either voluntary basis or on a on a paid position, but that paid position is across the board, and that's in all my projects, that paid position is actually living wage, which people get, and for me, if I work in the project, I get the same amount as the baker or as the woman behind the counter. So it's what we pay in the project, and that money comes through through what the bakery makes. So that's, and then of course the bakery or for the housing we ask grants, but for instance we tap into, there is a government scheme that says bringing derelict buildings back into life. So it's quite interesting, called the Empty Home Fund, because there's a lot of empty homes in England. So the Empty Home Fund, which is a government fund for derelict properties, gave us money to do up the houses again, but the city council didn't remove the demolition order, so we have money to do up houses, but we can't use it. So we use existing funds that is around, but that are there for all kind of like training funds, but it's not charity.
So do you think that your approach can work in a situation where you have isolation, where the community that's impoverished is in a situation where it needs to help itself out, but it can't really import aid or get funding? Do you think it's possible for a community to kind of just through increased talk and interaction fix itself without, like, in isolation and economic isolation?
I think things are a little bit more complex like that. Like things are also, like I said, like the urban fabric is a bit more, let's say, dynamic like that. I think what you see and what you saw, for instance, in Anfield happening is that what you see is that people were bogged down, you would say, through all processes. And in one way, some of them went along with some of the plans. They thought, oh, we get a new house. But to really understand what was happening to them took quite a long time, you know, to understand that you have to pay more for a new house, that you then maybe may not be able to afford it, you know, all these kind of things. So it takes a long time before people really understand the situation where they're in. And then to have to find a way, if you feel bogged down in your daily life, to act upon it, mm-hmm. is not that easy. So it's much more, and I think some of the way the story went viral to the New York Times helped the community to take a political stand. But before that, I think what happened, which was much more important, is that they sort of understood that it is possible to take matters into your own hands, to break open that sort of like that way in which our cities are sort of like, how you say, stifled. The fact that you have to think that you are in isolation, you have to wait for charity. You don't have to wait for something to come. You can sort of like start, you know, taking back that ownership of your own condition. So, but what does that then mean, you know, and stuff like that. And something that's been, for instance, I give you an example of smartness that I think. Like, Jane's family are hardcore people in the area. Her father's a very well-known activist in the area, always like been, you know, the worker strikes and stuff like that, been quite well-known, but even they had to move two times in the process. They were sort of like, they didn't want to be involved anymore. But besides the fact that she got involved because she was sort of curious, they are also big Anfield football fans, super big Anfield football. They have memberships to clubs in generations, stuff like that, and the Anfield football club is called Spirit of Shangri. And so at some point, because the bakery is a workers' co-op and a consumers' co-op, at some point Jane said, so what if we not go, why don't we go to the Spirit of Shangri and ask all the members of the football club to become a consumer member of our thing? If we do that, and that club has maybe 100,000, I don't know how many things, then that's a way to not only involve the football fans who come there every Sunday to go to a match, but it's also, you know, strengthening our foundation and bringing in foundation capital. So, and of course, they are, that's what I sell, low experts with certain knowledge. She is has the, her expertise is also partly that she's a football fan. So they managed to get the spirit of Shankly involved, and even the spirit of Shankly, this takes too long maybe to answer, but it's very funny. It's like when a home match starts, one of the members of spirit of Shankly can go to the middle point, stand and announces the match. And also like, welcome everybody, let the game begin, or something like that. Something they say, I've never been, so because the tickets are unaffordable if you're not a member. So, and she just basically asked not only the group to become members and to see the bakery as their preferred supplier during match days for Shankly pies, which we make, but also to use that moment to stand on the step and say, please, support your local business, and please, we, the spirit of Shankly, make home bake our preferred supplier. So this is what I call is also not only, you know, so that's not charity, that's just, you know, people taking people also seriously in their local expertise, but also seeing that as a resource which we all have to learn how to not only combine it, but also how to act. So this is just an example about how we make money.
Thank you.
And they're damn good pies.
You didn't bring enough to share. No, we have dessert for those who haven't gotten it yet. But yeah, we spent the semester and still another month reading academically about courage and about how to think about crossing that barrier between private and public life.